with Jeremiah chapter 19 and the last couple of verses. Verses 14 and 15. I want you to get your place and I want you to keep your Bible open. For I am sure this morning that the Lord wants to speak to many through this word. The context here is that Jeremiah has come back from the valley of Hinnom, from the valley of Tophet, or the valley of slaughter. Those names amongst them means the place of burning, and indeed the Concordance, Strong's Concordance says the place of cremation. And if you look at verse 14, it was the place that God sent them to. Then came Jeremiah from Tophet, where the Lord had sent him to preach. God had sent him to preach. Look at verse 4, the end of it. What was going on there? Well, they filled this place with the blood of the innocents. In verse 5, they built also high places of Baal to burn their sons with fire for burnt offerings unto Baal, which I commanded not, nor spake it, neither came it to my mind. Therefore, behold, the day is come, said the Lord, that this place shall be called no more Tophet, or the valley of the son of Hinnom, but the valley of slaughter. Now, whenever Jeremiah returned from there, after what he had witnessed, really broke the man. He had witnessed and heard the screaming. He saw the horror of the sacrifice of the children to the satanical Baal. And it must have been an awful sight. And it's obvious that he came back to the temple to deliver his message, that he was scathing with anger, holy indignation. And he comes back up to the temple gates. And we're going to see as a moment, as the hypocritical crowd, the religious crowd, were going up to the place of worship. He stood at the gate and delivered what was a fearless message to the people with his heart burning. He delivered to the people what was the first message, that God was going to take them into captivity, into Babylonish captivity. He told them in the verses following that the temple would be tossed, that the women and children would be ravished and murdered, and that the land would be left desolate. In fact, if you read verse 15, thus said the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, behold, I will bring upon this city and upon all her towns all the evil that I have pronounced against it, because they have hardened their necks and they might not hear my word. The people of Israel had crossed the Rubicon. They had gone so far and too far for God. Let me say this very carefully and with a burden this morning. When a nation slays their babes, whether it be physically with abortion or mentally in our schools or spiritually in our churches, as some are being taught things in church, in so-called churches, then the judgment of God is inevitable upon that nation. and upon that people. And it was this that tipped the balances with God as far as Israel was concerned. Then after delivering that awesome message, as we read some of it down in chapter 20, we read in verse 1, Now Pashur, chapter 20 and verse 1, Now Pashur, the son of Immer, the priest, who was called chief governor in the house of the Lord, heard that Jeremiah prophesied these things. This was the top government official officer in the temple. It seems that he wasn't there when he preached it, because the verse says, when he heard that Jeremiah prophesied. You'll not be very long until you'll get somebody to, if I would make some awesome statements regarding sodomites and others from this pulpit this morning, I'm sure it couldn't be very long till someone would carry it to the Belfast Telegraph or to Nolan. You'll always get somebody very soon to deliver the news that you're saying. Pashur here, the priest whose name means to be wealthy and to have plenty, he was a very nasty man. Now read what he done. In verse 2, Then Pashur smote Jeremiah the prophet and put him in the stocks that were in the high gate of Benjamin, which was by the house of the Lord. 39 lashes he ordered upon the servant of God, Jeremiah, and put him in the stocks, which was a thing that he went through his head and his feet, and where he was contorted in with pain, and 39 lashes of the whip, which was a cut him deep. Now we're looking at a man that has been preaching the truth of God's word. It was not only a Jew slamming a Jew, hammering a Jew, but it was a priest hammering a priest. For Jeremiah was from the priesthood family. And isn't it right that John Wesley said on one occasion that it's the nature of the wolf to slay the lamb, but it's not the nature of a lamb to slay another lamb? This man is wounded, been wounded deeply in the house of a friend. He wouldn't be the first servant of God who was wounded for preaching the truth by his own people. Remember the early apostles 700 years after this. John and Peter, the same crowd, they were the priests and the captain of the temple, laid hold upon them and put them into prison all night. The Apostle Paul says that five times he received 40 stripes, save one. Our Lord Jesus Christ at Gabbatha was slashed by his own people, wounded and broken there at that awful place called Gabbatha. Now here this man was pillared on the place of the high place, on the main street where everybody could see him. He was half stripped. He was in great pain. And as the people passed by, they mocked him. It's unbelievable, my friend, that these crowd were going in. They were going into the temple in their droves to worship God. And at the same time, they were slaying the children. I don't have time to elaborate on that this morning. But I can tell you that religion is an awful system. They mocked him and they derided him and they spat on him and they cursed him. Now in verse 3, it seems that Pascha come under conviction, because usually they kept them there until they died, but of course God's hand was on it. It came to pass on the morrow that Pascha brought forth Jeremiah out of the stocks. Now you'd have thought that when he got him out of the stocks, he would have been relieved and he would have mellowed a bit because of the fact that he's been taken away from the public gaze and he's getting maybe his wound seen to, but he doesn't. Now I want you to watch this very carefully, like a shot. He turns on him and he said to him, "The Lord has not called thy name. The Lord hath not called thy name Pascha, wealthy and powerful, but Maghar Mesabeb, which means fear will grip you and your family, and you'll go into Babylon captivity, and your whole family will die there." Read on. "For this saith the Lord," verse 4, "Behold, I will make thee a terror to thyself and to all thy friends, and they shall fall by the sword of their enemies, and thine eyes shall behold it, and I will give all Judah into the hand of the king of Babylon, and he shall carry them captive into Babylon, and shall slay them with the sword. Moreover, I will deliver all the strength of this city, all the labors thereof, and all the precious things thereof, and all the treasures of the kings of Judah will I give unto the hand of their enemies." This is the captivity, "which shall spoil them, and take them, and carry them to Babylon. And thou, Pascha, and all that dwell in mine house shall go into captivity. Thou shalt come to Babylon, and there thou shalt die, and shall be buried there, thou and all thy friends, to whom," watch this now, "thou hast prophesied lies." I want you to stop there now just for a moment, because here now is where our message kicks in this morning. Here is the third in these verses. I want to saturate yourself in these following verses this morning, because I say again, God has a message. God has a message. Here is the third of these essential, imperative, mandatory things that will ensure victory for this fellowship and any other fellowship as we go down into this 35th year. Remember the first one. I said there was three. This is the third one. Remember the first one. We saw there's a drone going on here at this. Remember, we saw that the first of them, we saw his unworthiness. His unworthiness. Remember, he said, "Ah, Lord, I can't do this. I am not able to do this. I'm only a child, and the job's too great for me." And we saw how unworthy he was, and that's a good thing when we get low enough to say, "We can't do it, Lord. Nor can we do what's before us at this assembly on our own." Then last week we saw brokenness. Brokenness, "Oh, that my head were waters and my eyes a fountain of tears." He was broken. But here this morning we have something maybe more important than it all. We're going to see something this morning that has spoken so greatly to my heart as I meditated upon these verses. Here we have an essential quality, and it's definitely needed in the 21st century church, evangelical church. And it is the word genuineness. Genuineness. And actually, the word genuine in the dictionary is the real McCoy. Authentic. a sincere, honest, and truthful person. Or in other words, the genuine article. On Wednesday night, we heard a testimony from a young man who was wayward and on drugs, and he said one of the things that kept him back was the Christian. One of the things that kept him back, now I know people can use that, but one of the things that kept him back was the testimony of some of the Christians around him. God help us. And God help you if you'd be a hindrance to any drug addict, any drunkard, or any man from coming to the Lord. Jeremiah comes back into the chamber, into the closet. And why wouldn't he be? He's mentally and he's physically and he's emotionally and he's spiritually exhausted. And when he comes back in after that night in the rack and the people walking by and spitting and shouting and mocking him, when he was wounded and stripped and beaten, when he had delivered the message of God that God had given down at Tufford, then he comes in verse 7. Now I want you to look at this verse 7. I had a wrestling match with these verses, let me tell you. He says, O Lord, thou hast deceived me, and I was deceived. Thou art stronger than I and hast prevailed. I am in derision daily. Everyone mocketh me. For since I spake, I cried out, I cried violence and spoil, because the word of the Lord was made a reproach unto me in the derision daily. Then I said, I will not make mention of him and speak again anymore. I'll not preach anymore. But his word was in mine heart as a burning fire shut up in my bones, and I was weary with forbearing, and I could not hold back. For I heard the defaming of many, fear on every side. Report, say then, we will report it on all my familiar watching for my halting, saying, peradventure he will be enticed, and we shall prevail against him, and we shall take our revenge on him. Now I want you to leave the next three verses, because commentators and scholars tell us that these three verses shouldn't be in here, they should be in a different place. Now, I don't know whether that's right or not, but it probably makes sense. Just leave the next three verses, verse 11, verse 12 and 13, and go to verse 14. This is a continuing on, if you leave those verses out. And here's what this mighty man of God said. Now watch what he said. Cursed be the day wherein I was born. Let not the day wherein my mother bare me be blessed. Cursed be the man who brought tidings to my father, saying, a man child is born unto thee, making him very glad. And let that man be as the cities which the Lord overthrew, that Sodom and Gomorrah, and repented not. And let him hear the cry in the morning and the shouting at noontide, because he slew me not from the womb, or that my mother might have been my grave. And I tell you, I could preach on that. Mother is the grave of thousands of children today in the nation. That my mother might not be my grave, and her womb to be always great with me. Wherefore came I forth out of the womb to see labor and sorrow, that my days should be consumed with shame. He mentions the womb three times, and he mentions born twice. You know the problem with Jeremiah here? He didn't go back far enough. He should have went back beyond the womb. We need to go back beyond the womb. That was the word the Lord given. Before I formed thee, created thee in the mother's womb, I knew you. He's making a mistake here. He's making a lot of mistakes here. Well, don't you lash him this morning, because by the time I'm done with this message, you'll see yourself, for I have seen myself in it. What's happening here in these verses? Well, I'll tell you what's happening here in these verses. The enemy has come through the servant of God. And he said to him, Jeremiah, you're wasting your time. You were right at the very beginning. You're not able for this. The load is too heavy. It's out of your depth. You have become a laughing stock. All hands are against you, even your own priestly family. Wise up, man. You're an extremist. You ever hear that? Didn't you once have fellowship with Pascal and his wife and his children? And he did, for they both lived in Ananoth. They were contemporaries. Did you not walk once into the house of the Lord with this priestly family? He did. And the voice is saying to him, now Jeremiah, pack it in. Instead of seeing souls and blessing and people repenting and turning to God and listening to the message, the opposite is the case. Face up to it, Jeremiah. God has tricked you. That was the word deceived means. God has tricked you. God has deceived you. You haven't seen anything in these number of years. Let me tell you, he never saw anything in the 30 years. Never seen any success, Jeremiah. And mind you, the worst is to come after this. And go on the enemy saying, listen, child sacrifice is multiplying. The idols are spreading. Wickedness is a premium across the land. It's getting worse, far, far worse from you started to preach. And all that's happening is you're getting attacked and abused. What does he do in verse 9? Look what he does. Then said, I will not make mention of any more or speak any more in my name. He resigns. He says, I'm finished with it. Now you just hold tight this morning. He says, I'm finished with this. I'm not going to talk or speak anymore. I'm done. It's over. Like old Jacob, all these things are against me and I can't go any further. Now I want to make this perfectly clear to you this morning. This is not a public resignation or declaration. This is a petition between him and his God. This has went on in the secret place. And the Holy Ghost has put it in print down through these centuries that we might learn from it. This is not for the ears of the scoffers. This is not for the critics or the mockers or for the press or for the church. This is a man genuinely sincere and honest before God. Can I say to you this morning, men like this, and there's plenty of them in the Bible, and there's plenty of them this morning, if they were genuine and owned up to it. And there's many in this church maybe this morning, if you don't up to it. Men like this never aired their grievances in public. Men like this never hung out their dirty washing in public. They go away in the weeping. Remember Elijah fled as far as he could and he left his servant behind and went out into the wilderness, into the desert to weep. The very same thing, weeping over God has forgotten. Do you remember whenever Lot and Abram parted on the mountain? You remember the herdsmen fell out over the cattle? And Abram said to Lot, he said, take your cattle and go because the Canaanites are watching us fighting. When Saul and Jonathan died suicide on Mount Gilboa, and the word came back to David. David said, tell it not in Gath. Publish it not in the streets of Ascalon. Let not the Philistines rejoice. Can I say this to you this morning? The tears, the sobs, the heart cry behind closed doors in your home are for your home. Now I know that at times we need help and we need counselors. And the sobs and the cries and the struggles that go on in a church meeting is for the church. Not for the world. And we need to hammer it out before God. We need to be truthful and genuine before God. And there's not one of us here this morning who hasn't experienced something like this. Lord, I can't say more. Lord, I can't handle the children anymore. And a woman weeping and crying with me during the week, she says, I can't handle it anymore. I can't handle my husband anymore. I can't handle my wife anymore. I don't know where to turn with my business. I don't know where to turn with my health. Everybody thinks that I'm all as well when I'm in the church and in the shops and in the school. You ever feel like that? Oh Lord, I pray and nothing happens. Lord, I cry and I wash and I iron and I cook and I do my best to bring up my family and nothing happens. It seems that you tricked me. It seems that you've deceived me. There's not a word. There's not a turn. Things are getting worse and worse. That's what a woman said to me some time ago. She says, the more I pray for the family, the worse they're getting. I tell you, there's many a pastor this morning, there's many a servant of God. And if we're honest, they've lamented and prayed and shed tears. Oh God, the church is split. The people are fighting. There's no souls. Did I get it wrong? I left my job. I've come here. I'm in derision. Many have handed in their resignation. Many have gone back into secular work. Maybe they didn't go as far as Job in 14 and 15, but sometimes in 16, sometimes they come near, as many have. But here, take this, my friend, this morning. This battered soul this morning. Mother. Father. When you're praying, you see the heavens are like grass and doesn't seem to be any change. I preach and I pray in the church and I have meetings and I have missions and I have this and I have that and I'm seeking God for my family and seeking God for this terrible burden that I have that nobody else knows anything about and it's worse it's getting. I can tell you, my friend, over the years that I have been here, I have prayed and I have fasted. I know people shouldn't talk about their fasting, but one of the things God laid on me is to fast. I can tell you I have prayed and I've fasted for days and weeks over certain things and it's worse to God. Worse to God. Then what is it that keeps you going? What is it that keeps you going? I'll tell you, it's in this wee butt here. It's in this wee butt. There's a butt here in verse 9. And here's where it is this morning. But his word. This is what stood to Jeremiah. This is what came to Jeremiah when he was in the worst of his days and the worst of his hours. When all seemed to fail and when all seemed to be gone, here's what came to them. But thank God for that wee book. But his word. It was his word that God gave to Jeremiah in chapter 1. It wasn't the word of some deacon or some elder or some man. It was his word. It wasn't the word of some committee. It was his word. That's what it says. His word. But his word was in mine heart.
I tell you, the word of God was in his heart, not in his hand. Thousands of people in Northern Ireland today, and the word of God is in their hand. And it wasn't in his head. Other and thousands of them have the word of God in their head, but have it in your heart. You're here this morning and you're not saved. The word of God may be in your hand. You maybe have it in your head from a child at the Sunday school. Have it in your heart. But I can tell you, if you come into trials and troubles like this, or trials and troubles in life as a Christian, and you haven't it in your heart, you're in trouble. He says, the word was hid in my heart like a fire. He says, it's burning in my heart and my bones. All the time that he was depressed, all the time that he was down, all the time that he was saying these things, all the time when all hell was upon him, and his back was lashed, and his sweat was running up him, and he was half naked, and nothing was happening, all the time the words he said was burning in my heart, and he said, I couldn't contain it. I couldn't keep it back. I can tell you this morning that the word of God burns in my heart for this place. All this heart. And I thank God every day that he gave me the words that I couldn't be here without it. I thank God that God one day gave me a word. Whether you agree or whether you agree with not what we are doing in this assembly, God has given us words. Do you know anything about the word of God coming to your soul and burning in your soul? On fire. Even in the worst days. I tell you, friend, if you have this to go back to, if you haven't this to go back to, the whole situation changed here. It changed suddenly here. Something happened here with this man. There was a word that was burning in his heart. Even with the resignation letter in his hand. And then he comes in with a second but in verse 11. But the Lord is with me. He's with me. Boy, he knew that. He knew the presence of the Lord. He knew the power of the Lord and the word in his heart burning in his soul. Tell me, is there a word burning in your soul this morning for souls? Is there a word burning in your soul this morning for revival? Is there a word burning in your soul this morning because of the slaying of the children? And as this man went down the pulpit to preach, I thank God for every man that goes to the slaughtering houses of the abortionists and stand and preach. I thank God for those who stand at the Craig Avon Hospital to open their mouth for the dumb and preach for the innocent children that have been slain in the mother's womb of their grave. I thank God for every one of you. There's a word burning in this man's heart and it was like a fire. It was like a fire. Verse 11, the presence, Lord, you're with me. You're with me as a mighty, terrible one. In spite of what I'm saying, in spite of how I feel, Lord, I know thou art with me. I know that the Lord sent me. I know that the Lord called me. And whether there's fruit or whether there's results or not, what does it matter? Doesn't matter anything, my friend, if we never see another soul here. If we never see a child in the school here. God is faithful. Jeremiah never saw anything. I tell you, he saw nothing. They put him into a pit of slurry after this. They hammered him. They lied about him. They beat him. And at the end of the journey, he never saw one thing. But I'll tell you this, he was faithful. And I thank God for the faithful people of this assembly. I thank God for you people. Some of you traveled miles and had hardiness tonight at the tent. I thank God for you. I thank God for those who stand and help us and back up with us. I thank God for those women that were in the barn last night cooking something for the young ones. Mothers that have plenty to do on a Saturday night, let me tell you. I thank God for them up the lane, thanking God for them. Thank God for the Sunday school staff. I thank God for the Friday night workers who come, sometimes see children. I thank God. See, God's going to reward faithfulness. Are you faithful to this assembly? Are you faithful to any assembly? Many nights we get the mission to encourage the people. Many Friday mornings we in the prayer meeting. Just ask your heart out this morning. The presence of God was with them. And I say to some young men and women in this meeting this morning that are thinking of Bible college, thinking of missionary work, thinking of something for God, don't dare move or go or even consider anything if you haven't the word. You haven't that word burning in your heart and in your soul. Jeremiah says, I can't hold it in. See, the word of God is a fire and the fire burns. The word of God is a sword and the sword pierces. The word of God is a hammer and the hammer breaks. The mighty word of God. But I want to close this morning with another but. So there's three buts here, and the last but is in verse 12. This is where I say I think the scholastic translators are right, that it should be the last three verses, these. And the other verses, verse 14, should have come in after that verse on up there. That's beside the point. And even if not, even these verses are in the right place, we can dip again, you know. Even they're in the right places. Even he is elated and even he's seeing all this. He can go down again. We'll go down again. But I don't know where they should be. But I want to close the other bit, this bit in verse 12. But O Lord of hosts, that triest the righteous and seest the reins in the heart, let me see thy vengeance on them unto thee. Have I opened my cause? Here sing ye the Lord, praise ye the Lord, for he has delivered the soul of the poor from the hand of the evildoers. What is he saying here? He's calling the people to praise. That's what he's doing. Sing, he's saying to the people, sing unto the Lord and praise ye the Lord, for he has delivered the soul of the poor from the hand of the evildoer. You try praise this morning? Have you ever tried praise and thanksgiving? He that offereth praise glorifieth God. See, when you have the word of God shut up in your heart and the word of God is released, it will be released in praise and thanksgiving. It doesn't matter what the situation is. It doesn't matter. God's people are called to be holy people. God's more interested in holiness than our happiness. Or there are happenings. Happening is something that will happen and make you glad today if you get a phone call from somebody. It'll make you glad tomorrow morning if you get a check from somebody, you get promotion at work. Those are happenings. Those will make you glad. God's not interested in happenings. That'll only put you up for a minute, you'll be down the next day. These things will only give you a spurt. And dear knows what will come this week. You'll be up and you'll be down. You'll be up and you're down. God's not interested in happiness. He's in your holiness. Are you holy before God? Are you clean before God? Are you open before God? That's what he's interested in. Because let me tell you this, if your hands are clean and your heart is pure and you're nothing betwixt you and God every day, I'll tell you this, every day you'll be praising the Lord. You'll thank him for your family no matter what way they are. You'll thank him for the children no matter how they go. You'll thank him for your husband no matter how things are going. You'll thank him for the work no matter how things are going. You'll praise him and you'll thank him. This man has burst out into praise here. Just like Paul and Silas, when they were beaten and whipped and then scourged, and in the inner part of the prison, they began to sing, they began to pray and to sing praises unto the Lord. Praise him this morning in your trial. Praise him in your affliction this morning. Praise him in that situation in your home this morning. Praise him in that situation with your family and your children this morning. Praise him, praise him. And stop complaining and criticizing and running the country. Then before God and closed the door, it was when God heard this heart cry. God brought this man to a heart cry. I tell you, friend, when God heard the heart cry of this man, like a flash he came to. He came to. Things are not answered the way we want them answered. I don't want you to turn to this, but I want to close with Hebrews 13 and verse 15. Know what it says there? Jesus, our Savior, who shed his own blood and suffered without the gate on the cross for our sin. Then it says this, the writer of the Hebrews, let us go forth unto him. Jeremiah hadn't him. He hadn't him. He was in the Old Testament. We have him this morning. We have the mighty Savior this morning. And then it says this, for here we have no continuing city, but we seek one to come. A lot of how it pans out here, listen, the best is yet to be, Mother. For here we have no continuing city, but we seek one to come by him. It's him again. Let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually. That is the fruit of our lips. Giving thanks to his name. Forgetting not what he has done. For such sacrifice, what sacrifice? The sacrifices of praise. Mine is not easy to praise in the storm. The sacrifice of praise, God is well pleased. This man has broke out in praise and he's calling us to praise him. The problem hasn't been sorted out. Things haven't changed. The children are still being slain. The people are still going into captivity. Wickedness is in every hand. Things haven't changed, but he has changed. He's got his eyes off himself. He's got his eyes off the situation. He's got his eyes on the God. Thou art with me. The last five Psalms begin and end with praise. You know that? Why don't you form a habit of reading them every day? They're not long Psalms, they're short Psalms. Every one of them begin with praise. And end with praise. And I knew there's some stuff in the Psalms you wouldn't be praising for.
An average of 6 times in each psalm, you have the word praise. Now here's my punchline as we close this morning. The 149th psalm, the one before the last. Here's what it says. Here's what the psalmist says. Let the saints be joyful in glory. Let them sing aloud upon their beds. And here's the bit. Let the high praises of God be in our mouths and the two-edged sword in our hand. That's it. You see, somebody all the halves of the sword. Put you in two. Put you in every meat. Put the wee children to put the families in there. They don't come up to the standard that they want. Just the word. He's dead as the devil. The letter killeth. There's so many across our land this morning and so many assemblies and places this morning. The word. And thank God for the word. And thank God for the cross. And thank God for the blood. But that's a bird with only one wing. And a bird with only one wing can't fly. There's two wings. What does the psalmist say? What does he end up with? All the mighty sayings in the psalm. What does he end up almost saying? With the praises of God in our mouth and the two-edged sword in our hand. Oh, my dear friend, they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. We need the Holy Spirit. We need to be filled with the Holy Ghost. We need to worship him in spirit and in truth. And then let the word loose. Forward, believers, into the 35th year. Forward, no matter what the critics say. Forward, no matter what the gabblers and the murmurs say. Forward on, no matter how they attack us or what they say about us. Forward on. You know, I've stopped listening to people criticizing, especially those who are never in the prayer meeting. I'll go on, but I'll not spoil the meeting. I want to say to you this morning, we need to go forward in unity. We need to go forward together into battle. Onward, upward, heavenward, homeward. And here's the keys this morning. And if we can get a grip of these, unworthiness, I can't do it. I am worthless. I am useless. We can't do it. Can't save my family. I can't change my child. I can't do it. Unworthiness, brokenness, Lord, I'm broken vessel, I'm poured out, I can't do it, Lord. Oh God, my eyes are waters and my fountain of tears, I'm broken, Lord. And then the genuine, no old bluffing, no Lord making out things of that or when they're not. Get before God like this honest man. Jeremiah says, Lord, please, if you're tricking me this evening, you have something to go back to, have the word. Give the word in your heart this morning. If you have the word in your heart and in your hand, let me tell you, we can go forward. And let me say this, the victory. Yeah. Yeah.